Welcome back. Okay, so there's a lot to cover. We're getting right into the heart of the whole divorce story. So what you're going to see here is how manipulative he could be and how he could take, you know, pieces and parts of stories and make them work, and how there was a lot of kind of a collective decision to not to be discerning. You go along with all of this stuff, you had to not be searching for the truth very hard. I'd be willing to buy into the whole notion of, well, her whole family is doing it, and I get it. That was probably a big seller. But I have been talking about being depressed, and I've mostly been talking about it with my husband and with my parents, which was completely the wrong thing to do. When I talk about doing the wrong thing, this is among the wrong things. I should have been talking to friends, girlfriends, a therapist about what was going on. But I had all these rules and ways of being from that I grew up with that I just transferred over into how I was as an adult. And I had a big don't see, don't hear, don't tell policy from that I grew up with. And it would to be an act of love and an act of loyalty and all of that was to, not tell other people about what was wrong with your family. Plus, I didn't really know it. You know, the truth is I didn't know what was wrong with anybody. I knew that I was sad. And frankly, I didn't know that I was being abused because it wasn't inconsistent from how I was ever treated by my parents or anything. So until I was ready to fully embrace reality, which was that I had always been abused, it would have been hard for me to see it, because to me it just looked like I was being treated like I was always treated by my parents. And that was how I defined love. So it was very, very tricky. But I believe that the real explanation for what happened was that I was, dying of heartache. The toll that this situation was taking on my body, and the fact that it was taking on me, and the stress of cognitive dissonance, which is another one of my videos where I talk about the difference between what you believe is true and what is playing out in your life, or what you are acting like, what you're saying, and what you know is true. Like there's a things aren't matching up. So you might be saying my life is perfect and it looks perfect, but your husband's not coming home and he's not sleeping in your bed and he's mean to you, or we have this perfect family, but you know on some level that they're cruel to you. You feel disconnected and like they don't love you, like they don't care about you. Those are distances, but it's not, you don't fully know it, and you don't fully embrace it. And so embracing reality gets to be a big part of my recovery, and that'll be like the end section of this story. What basically goes into happening next is that there is just this domino effect of complicated, purposeful manipulations of the truth. I have no idea that my husband or my parents would be undermining me. Like, that's the furthest notion. That's the furthest thing from my mind that I would ever think that the people that I built my life around, the people that I had that I thought were closest to me, were actually my only real enemies. And that was, the people that should be my protectors against who, I don't know, because they were my enemies. It was so far from my frame of reference that I really don't even figure it out until it's way too late, until I am looking at it all almost in retrospect, until I'm looking at the damage done. I don't get on top of it in time to save anything for a while, a year or so. My husband's just mad. He's just always mad, and there's no explanation for it. He would say, I don't know why I'm mad, I just am. And he may not really have even known. He just wanted out. He wanted to drive me away. He wanted to change. He needed new supply, whatever it was. He was already mad even before the heart attack happened. And then after it happened, he was clearly mad that I didn't die. Clearly mad that he felt especially trapped now. Now I really can't leave because she just almost died, and how I'm going to look like the bad guy if I leave. He would always say, he would tell me, if I ever leave you, I'm just gonna walk away with, I'll just walk away with the clothes on my back. You'll never see me again. Like it was, he would say it like it was something dramatic, like he wanted to say it. Like he wanted to be, it was like when he wanted to be true, that he could be like cool and like, that's like a cowboy thing to do. But the truth of it is that he wasn't gonna leave without, he wasn't gonna leave anything behind. I thought, it looked like we all wanted the same thing. And that was always true. It looked like my parents and I always wanted the same thing. But the big difference was, I really wanted it, and they were satisfied with it looking like it. Whereas I really wanted this really close, loving family, and I really wanted, I really wanted deep connection, and they wanted it to look like they had it, but they did not want to do it. They didn't want to be there for somebody. They didn't want to put kids ahead of their own needs. They didn't want to put anybody, they didn't want to consider anyone else's needs at all. But they didn't want to look selfish. They wanted to look like loving people. They just didn't want to be loving people. That was always a disconnect for me, and that was always really hard for me to get on top of. And you only have what's in your own frame of reference, so it's very, very hard to understand how someone else is thinking when it is just absolutely outside of any way that you would ever know to think. And I've only been able to do it now because I've watched it all play out, I've studied it, and I know it in an intellectual way. I've learned it, but just going by what you think is like, you know, because we assume that people are just like us, you know. And one thing we assume is no one ever talks about it. This is like the thing, this is the most taboo thing I think I've realized. You know, people say politics are taboo and sex is taboo. And you know what the most taboo thing to talk about is? Love. No one wants to talk about love. And we have such a collective misunderstanding of what love is. And so people like my ex-husband, they could throw around the notion of love all the time. My all these people that I'm talking about, now granted, my family, my parents never told me they loved me. They didn't throw love around at all. They do more now, but all these people throw around the word love, and yet there was an absolute absence of love in all these stories. So as I'm talking, as I finish telling you the rest of these stories, and you know, some of the details of them are just outrageous. Just think that there's a solution all along. There's a solution to all of it. And there's a solution to all these personality disorders and all this narcissism epidemic. And there's a solution to every problem in this story and every problem all of us have had. And that solution, well, the solution is love. But love is so complicated, none of us understand what it is. I mean, it's actually very simple, but it's not easy. And it's not easy to understand because people make it mean all kinds of different things. So I find it easier to talk about compassion. Compassion is empathy with action. So if you think about that, so the answer to all of this would have been compassion, which is empathy, feeling what the other person is feeling, put yourself in their shoes, and then putting action in it, behaving in a way that helps the situation, that is productive, creative, and helpful, and not more destructive, not causing more harm. There are a lot of things at play here that made it so that this situation was so destructive. And it was very destructive to me, obviously, and it was very destructive to my kids, obviously. But I want to also say that it was destructive to everyone it touched, even if they aren't even aware of it. I noticed that there is a whole group of people that were really more decent people before they got involved in this. And to whatever degree that this touched their life, whether they just, you know, to the degree that they knew it, they were lessened. And sadly, no one was elevated. No one was elevated. But how you would have been elevated would have been that you would have come in and said, no, that's not good enough. We're gonna do something better for these kids. Or elevated would have been, you know, stepping in and helping my kids, you know, just being there for them, like taking them over to your house and letting them have peace with your kids, or you know, there's just a million ways. There were people that did that that didn't know us to begin with. People that did come in and helped us out didn't know us when this started. There were some friends that did stand by me, and they would definitely have helped me out, but I didn't know what to have them do, you know. So they were there when I was ready to talk to them, but I didn't know what to ask them to do. And this situation had taken me so far out of you know I had these friends that at one point we had something in common, and when this was over, not only I mean I was like someone that none of us would ever have known. First of all, I didn't have any money. I was not like the person that I was, you know, that, you know, was just who I would, had I never met this person, I wasn't that person. I was completely destroyed. I was like a person who had, I didn't have any money. I was completely, my body was completely broken. My health was destroyed. My confidence was destroyed. I had no family. I was like an orphan. And I was more, I felt like a hunted animal. I mean, I was really, I didn't know who to trust. Like, there were some people that that I trusted that ended up harming me because they didn't know any better. And so there were a few people that did something like that where they got involved in something that they just didn't understand. They had poor judgment and they weren't very discerning. At some point, you know, these were not new people in my life. These were people that knew me for all my life, you know. Or they knew me at least the 10 years, at least for a decade, you know. So, you know, I had proven who I was. What ended up being alleged against me were things that no one had ever seen any evidence of my doing in my life, ever. There was no one had ever seen anything like it. And there was, and of course, the only witness was this, you know, was my ex-husband. He was the one alleging it was the only one who had ever seen it. And I make some really big mistakes. And it's because I still am trusting. I'm still trusting my husband. I don't think that, you know, I just don't think of him as as sinister as he was. About a year after the heart attack, I tell my husband that I think I should get off the pain medication because I didn't expect to be on it this long, and it doesn't seem there's any plan for, you know, I thought that I was going to be better by now. There's nothing that they can do, and so I don't want to be on this medication forever. And so, you know, I'm telling him that I think I should get off medication. And partly the reason I'm doing that, it's true, I should, but I also am really lonely, and I really want support. And I feel like, what do I have to do for someone to show me that they care about me? You know, I should be dead. I should be dead. One piece that I don't explain, you'd have to watch the near-death experience to understand this, so I'm going to throw this in there. At one point, when I am dying and I'm having the heart attack, and I think, thank God, I don't have to keep doing this anymore. At that point, I don't know the truth about all of the family. They have started putting me down so much, and I actually don't know that I'm that great of a mom. I don't know that they're that bad of a family. And I start to think maybe my kids would be better off without me. Maybe they would be better off with just all of them. It seems to be everyone agrees that that would be the case. Maybe, you know. So I really didn't know at that point that the quality of my love was different from theirs, or that they, you know, I didn't know that if I were to die, that there would be no one loving them left. So, you know, I just thought that I was like this depressed, hated person in their life, that they would have peace and they wouldn't have a depressed person in their life. They would have happiness and peace and a family that didn't have this black sheep. You know, I was the scapegoat, so they wouldn't have me, the one with all the problems, if I wasn't around. I really was holding my kids back, you know. So, I mean, it wasn't until I actually died and on the other side in my near-death experience saw that my kids desperately needed me and what would happen to them if I died. And it was that picture, that seeing that, that pulled me back to life. It was like, I've got to get back to life. I cannot have that happen to my children, because it was the saddest, most tragic sight I'd ever seen. It was like they were just, they were little boys, but they were just hollow in their eyes. They didn't know anything about love. They didn't, they had to forget all about me because it was too painful to remember. And they had no one in their life that loved them, and no one outside of their family knew that they were orphans, because they had family around, and so no one knew. Just like all the outsiders of this whole thing were looking at me and thinking I had family, thinking I had support. They didn't know that I was an orphan or that I was being attacked by my own family. No one knew. Because it looked like one thing and was completely another. My story is definitely a story of things not being what they seem, and it's a very important message to remember that things are not always what they seem. And one of the reasons for us doing this channel and us talking about this is because this wouldn't have happened if this community of people knew what they were looking for, how to label the things that they saw going on. But there were a lot of things working against me here. My own optimism, my own defense mechanisms and weighing of being that I learned from childhood with narcissistic parents. Lovelessness was huge. The lack of compassion, the lack of empathy, and the lack of love, which those are prerequisites to love. The lack of love was the biggest one for sure. And then people that don't have a conscience, and the fact that they were willing to do just about anything. Nothing really stopped them, you know. And if you're a parent that doesn't love your children, it makes it possible for you to do all kinds of things. You know, he could do all kinds of things to our kids that I couldn't do. He could do all kinds of things to me that would hurt the kids that I could never do to him. So, later on, down the road, like the family would say things like, she turned the kids against us, or the kids don't ever see us because of her, you know. They don't understand. That's their narcissism talking. They don't understand that as a mother who loves them, as a compassionate mother who loves them, I could never do that. I could never do what they were doing. I could never do what they did to me, because I love my kids too much. I would never have talked badly about their family that they love. If a family was good for them and was loving to them and they loved them back and they needed them, I would never ever have been able to get in the middle of those relationships and try and sabotage those relationships and try and, ruin. I would never be able to get in the way of stopping someone, ruining somewhere where my kids could get love and coming in between that, because I love them too much. I could never do it. So on the one hand, there were all these things that was never a fair fight, because he could do things, they could all do things that I could never do. On the other hand, because I love them so much, I could do things they could never do. I could endure things. Now, I was a superhero in a lot of ways. I mean, I had things I never thought I could do because I loved them so much. It was up to me, and I had to. I'm injured now. I am. Before this happened, I was taking antidepressants, and nothing was working. Nothing was working. But I thought maybe it was. And so I just kept trying to take it, and I kept going to counseling and saying, I don't know what's wrong. My life is so perfect. I don't know why I'm so sad. I mean, I just wasn't putting two and two together. And I was minimizing things, how bad they were. They were really, really bad. I was being really emotionally abused and really neglected. And, my mother, whenever I would go and try and talk to my mother about any of it, because I did eventually start trying to do that, she was always clearly blamed me. And my husband, who basically the deal with him was, and this is another place that like the sadness had kind of come from, because when I met him, the deal was that, I knew that my parents couldn't meet my emotional needs. And so when I met him, the deal was that he was going to meet my emotional needs that we all knew my parents couldn't. And what this felt like to me was, you know, back then he was saying, you know, he couldn't understand how they could act that way, blah, blah, blah. Now, a decade later, it felt like he was confirming, of course, you are so impossible to love. Look, you know, now I understand why your parents were like that. So, you know, that was pretty brutal. It seemed like to me, right, what I felt like is he just figured out, it's, you know, it took 10 years for him to figure out why my parents act the way they did towards me, why I was so unlovable.
There is stuff going on that I could not have imagined in a million years. I mean, it is like a movie. I just cannot believe that things are happening. It really was like a movie where, like, you know, those movie sequences where it's just like, where they start to realize things, they're just like shuffling through things, and then their mind starts going back, and they remember, oh my gosh, that was completely happening. That was completely happening. And again, talking about the things that I did wrong, oh my God, so did things wrong. The thing to do when you are going to be divorcing a person with a personality disorder that lacks conscience and all that, the thing you have to do is have your ducks in a row. Say nothing until you're acting on it. You have to have them in the position he had me in, which is that you have your plan halfway in it happening before you're letting them in on it. You know, you have it all figured out before you tell them anything. I did not ever do that. I was always behind. For all I know, he had the plan figured out 10 years earlier. You know, I certainly think he had, you know, when you think about it, I believe that he had it figured out at least 2 years earlier when he gave me that birthday party, because he wanted a reason to get all of my friends' phone numbers, and then he wanted to set a precedent where it wouldn't seem all that weird that he would contact them, where he would have a friendly relationship with them that was independent of me, where he could contact them directly and it wouldn't seem totally strange. Years after it had happened, when I was looking at the video, I was like, oh, yeah, now I see. I think that he was thinking about things like that all the time. I mean, when you think about it, how was it that he remembered the story that I was telling him the very first time we met? I never brought it back up again, and then he thought to tell that story to my parents 10 years later. The story about my not remembering my childhood, and now I'm having some flashbacks and all that. I hadn't talked to him about that in 10 years. At that point, I stuffed it, and after that, I had other things that were constantly coming before. At the time, I had a whole life with children and stuff. At that point, I was all about the kids in my life, that I was, you know, wasn't about my childhood at all anymore. So it was, you know, likely never going to come back up. But the fact that he knew, the fact that he saw my family, he saw the dynamic going on in my family immediately when he met us, and he remembered that triggering thing to use 10 years later. I mean, that's spooky to me. That is so super spooky. So, you know, that can only mean to me that he always knew, in all the times when I'm thinking that we're going to be little old men and women out in the, you know, he's going to look at me and I'm a little old lady with his, you know, think, oh, she's so, you know, I'm so lucky I had her, that he never thought that day was going to come. He always knew that one day he was going to completely destroy me.